We now present the holy oils which were blessed and consecrated by Archbishop Naumann this past Tuesday at the Chrism Mass for the sacramental life of our parish community. First, we bring the oil of the sick, blessed by Archbishop for the anointing of all those who suffer in mind and body. As the sick are anointed with the holy oil, we pray that they gain strength even in their suffering, that they be released from fear, that they have the consolation of faith, and that they might know the support of the church community for them. The oil of the sick is presented this evening by Paul Ballantyne. The next, we bring the oil of the catechumenates, blessed by the Archbishop for the anointing of all infants, children, and adults who are called to receive the holy sacrament of baptism. Through this anointing, we pray that they receive the strength and renounce sin and evil, and so approach the waters of baptism. The oil of catechumenates is presented this evening by Jenny Batten. Next, we bring the holy chrism, a mixture of oil and fragrant perfume consecrated by the Archbishop to anoint children in baptism and all in the sacrament of confirmation, to anoint the hands of the priest at their ordination, and to anoint the altar and walls of church when they are dedicated to God. The holy chrism is presented this evening by Aaron Fritz.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, we have reached the pinnacle of the liturgical year, the Triduum and the Easter mysteries. And tonight we celebrate Holy Thursday, where we are given the gift of the priesthood and the gift of the Eucharist. We have so much to celebrate because God is so good to us. But before we do that, let us recognize our need for His mercy and call to mind our sins. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. And therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, who have called us to participate in this most sacred supper, in which your only begotten Son went about to hand himself over to death, entrusted to the church a sacrifice new for all eternity, the banquet of his love, grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall stand at the head of your calendar. You shall reckon it the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel, on the 10th of this month, every one of your families must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one and shall share in the lamb, in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a year old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, and then, with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to two doorsteps and the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night they shall eat its roasted flesh with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This is how you are to eat it: with your loins girt, sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. You shall eat like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on this same night I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the house where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate with a pilgrimage to the Lord as a perpetual institution." The word of the Lord.
Communion.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread, and after he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Before the feast of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to pass from this world to the Father. He loved his own in the world, and he loved them to the end. The devil had already induced Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot, to hand him over. So during supper, fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God, he rose from supper and took off his outer garments. He took a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with the towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing, you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me."
Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew who would betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and put his garments back on and reclined at table again, he said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I, therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, it's always good to celebrate Holy Thursday. I have to admit, this year is a little bit different than last year. Last year was nice because it fell on my birthday and because Father Mark preached, so it's a lot calmer and easier and less stressful during the day for me, not needing to worry about what I was going to say. But on a more serious note, this year is got a little bit of sadness to it, because tonight we celebrate the gift of the Eucharist, but also the gift of the priesthood. And we come with sadness in our hearts knowing that one of our priests is not with us. But a priest is given an indelible mark that never goes away. We are a priest forever. And so we know that Father Travis continues to exercise his priesthood at the heavenly altar, offering the Son to the Father for all of our sakes, just as he did here. And we give thanks and praise to God for that. Tonight, we, in our liturgy, are present, are brought to the upper room, and we're brought to the garden. The upper room is here at the altar. And at the end of Mass, with our procession, we will end at the garden, a little makeshift garden that we've placed out in the narthex. But the truth is, what we celebrate tonight is also tied to the city of Tabgha. Tabgha is a city on the northwest edge of the Sea of Galilee. It's no longer inhabited, but it's believed that that is where Jesus multiplied the loaves and the fishes. It's there where we could say that Jesus's following was at its peak. In the sixth chapter of John, we're told that there were 5,000 men, just men. It doesn't number the women and the children. I think we could safely say there were 10,000 people there. To give you some perspective, that is 12 times the crowd that is in the church right now. Jesus was famous. Jesus was at the peak of his fame. Tonight, what we celebrate in the upper room is how that crowd of 10,000 gets whittled down to 12. And what we celebrate back there in the narthex, in the garden, it's down to 3. And even they end up leaving. Jesus goes from 10,000 followers to no one. Or at least to three. Friends, I ask you tonight, are you part of the 10,000? Or are you part of the three? Everyone loves a crowd. Everyone wants to be part of something that's popular. But do we really want to be part of the 10,000? Or do we want to be part of the three? Because what caused the decline? That great contraction from so many followers to so few. It wasn't that Jesus, in that sixth chapter of John, gave out a bunch of rules. And after those 10,000 had been fed by the loaves and the fishes that seemed to be endless, they were then told what they could and couldn't do, and they're like, well, we don't want to do this. We don't want to follow rules. We're done. That's not what sent them away. Now, in that sixth chapter, Jesus tells them that unless they eat his flesh and drink his blood, they have no life in them. That the bread that he was going to give was his flesh for the life of the world. That's what makes them question. And when they say, this is a hard saying, how can we follow this? Jesus doesn't bend. He doesn't back down or water down. In fact, he doubles down and says you must gnaw on the flesh and the blood of the Son of Man to have life within you. And that is too much for them. Can this man give us his flesh to eat? Really? I don't think so. I'm done. And in droves, they left him. And with time, that group whittled down to 12. And then in the garden, three. It's not too dissimilar today. Yes, in the church, we see a lot of people leaving. And sometimes it's because of the rules. We don't want to conform our lives to the truth of the gospel. It's hard sometimes. And so, yes, some people walk away. But we also see a lack of belief in Jesus' true presence in the Eucharist. 70% of Catholics say, I can't believe that. Even though Jesus says it is his body and blood and says that we must eat his flesh and drink his blood to have life, 70% of Catholics say, I don't want to believe that. The church, though, like Jesus, doesn't back down, hasn't watered down. She continues to double down and say, no, this really is Jesus. It is really substantially changed into his body and blood. Even if you don't want to believe it, even if you leave the church, we cannot change the truth of the Eucharist. And so I ask you again, friends, are you part of the 10,000 who were satisfied with being fed amazing food that seemed to be endless? The 10,000 who wanted to see miracles? Are you part of the three that continued to be faithful even when Jesus' teachings got hard. Do you want to be a part of the three? Are you willing to be a part of the three, even if everyone else stops believing? Because, friends, that's their loss. That was the loss of those 10,000 that walked away. They lost the gift that Jesus wanted to give. Jesus is giving us a gift at every Eucharist, the gift of himself. But because he is such a generous giver, it doesn't end with just this is Jesus' body and blood. There are so many other things that come along with it. Tonight, when you are being encouraged to ponder whether you're part of the three or the 10,000, if you're willing to say you are part of the three, who are willing to follow Jesus when he says these hard things, I ask you how you're going to respond to his gift tonight. That gift of his body and blood that includes so many other gifts. Those of you who are in RCIA, who will have your feet washed, who brought up the oils, who will bring up the gifts. In the Eucharist, do you see the gift of the source of the sanctifying grace that some of you will receive for the first time 2 days from now? In just a little while, when we wash the feet of the 12, will you see in that an act of love? An act of love that we are called to imitate. An act of love that we can do better when we are strengthened in love by the Eucharist. When I elevate the consecrated host and hold up the consecrated blood in the chalice, will we think about all of those capital sins Father Mark and Deacon Tom and I were preaching about during Lent, and recognize that in the Eucharist, we're forgiven of our venial sins, but it's also the power of the Eucharist in the confessional that forgives us even of our mortal ones. When we exchange the sign of peace, will we recognize that that person whose hand we are shaking or whom we are hugging, we are united with them in ecclesial unity, in a bond in the church that comes about through the Eucharist? When we come forward and we receive the Eucharist, will we recognize that what we receive tonight makes us present at what happens tomorrow, which makes us eligible for what we celebrate on Sunday? The Eucharist ties the whole Triduum, all of the mystery of Christ, together, and gives us a share every time we receive. And at the end of Mass, when we process the Blessed Sacrament all the way through the church, leading to that temporary garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus comes past you, will you in your heart ask him, as he's willing to do at every Eucharist, to increase your faith, to increase your hope, and to build up all the moral virtues in your heart? Friends, Jesus gives us a gift. What a travesty if we don't believe him. What a travesty if it's too hard and we're part of the 10,000 that walk away. Even if we don't walk away physically, that walk away in our hearts. You know, Tabgha and the upper room, they come up again, even after the Last Supper and the garden. Jesus appears in his risen body in Tabgha and encourages Peter to feed the church. And then the Holy Spirit comes down upon those 12 in the upper room and enlivens them to preach the truth of the gospel, the truth of the Eucharist. And thousands were converted. There was this great contraction during the life of Jesus, all the way down to him being by himself. But through the power of the Eucharist, there was a great expansion that continues throughout time. Now we may say, yeah, we're in a period of contraction. That may be true. But friends, if we're willing to be part of the three, if we're willing to believe Jesus and take him at his word, when he says, this is my body, this is the cup of my blood, and if we trust his promises that if we receive that, we receive life, then we will realize the gift that we are given. We will be transformed. And we, like those 12, will be used to expand the church again.
Now, imitating our Savior, we wash the feet of his disciples. Now we stand and turn to the Lord with all of our prayers and needs, knowing that we have a God who was good enough to send his Son to save us, and so he listens to all of our prayers.
That our priests will be strengthened by the Holy Spirit, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That nations throughout the world will renew their commitment to peace and justice, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who seek the Easter sacraments will embrace the cost of discipleship, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our community of faith will live as servants of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our government will enact laws to protect all lives, especially the unborn, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are sick, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of our deceased family and friends, and especially for Father Travis, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our Mass intention, which is offered for all who keep a holy hour in the Adoration Chapel, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those intentions on our hearts this Holy Thursday, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Father in heaven, we turn to you. We are so grateful for all of your gifts, especially the gift of your Son in the Eucharist and the gift of the priesthood. Please help us to cherish those gifts and to use them to bring about great good for your church. For we ask for all things through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God so loved.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he is the true and eternal priest who instituted the pattern of everlasting sacrifice and was the first to offer himself as the saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong. And as we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth,
plenis uncieli et terra, gloria tua. Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus qui venit in nomine Domini. Hosanna in excelsis.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Joseph, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day on which our Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers and all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. on the day before he was to suffer for our salvation and the salvation of all, that is, today, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium fidei.
Mortem tuam annunciamus Domine, et tuam resurrectionem confitemur.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Lord, your servants, especially Father Travis, who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace, grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. And to us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Peace. Thank you for your priesthood. Peace be with you. Thank you for diaconate. You can fix it, deacon. Thanks. Okay.
Peace
with you.
Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Covenant in my blood, says the Lord.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that just as we are renewed by the supper of your Son in this present age, so we may enjoy his banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
At this time, we will have our solemn procession around the church, and I invite you to be kneeling or sitting as we do that, and to remain in silence, and we're going to exit eventually and then come back into the narthex. And I encourage you, if you can, to just remain here silently in prayer, and then after we're reposed, after the Blessed Sacrament is posed back there, then you can exit silently. And I encourage you to keep that silence until you get to your cars. You're also welcome to join us in the narthex. We will the Blessed Sacrament will be there until 11 o'clock. For you to come and pray with our Lord when he's there by himself, basically. Be one of those who's willing to be there with him, one of the three that are there to be with our Lord who gave his life for us and gives himself to us every time we come to the Eucharist. Please kneel. Thank you.
Glory, O